Everybody, welcome back to another episode of the Cello Show. Thank you very much for being with us. I have the honor, the privilege of having my great friend and great mentor. I call him the mentor of all mentors, Dr. Steve Wexner. Remember when we did part one with Billy Rosato, as a surgeon, he was so busy. That was the day that he had surgery. So he was attending the patient, so he couldn't be here. But he was gracious enough to reschedule, and he is with us today. Hi, Steve. How are you?
Great, Marcelo. How are you? Great to see you.
Awesome. Awesome. And also the great Keoni with us. Hey, Captain America.
I am doing great. I have never met Dr. Steve in a day in my life, but I've heard so much about you because Cello was one of my acting students, and you know, sometimes he was difficult and sometimes he was easy to work with, and he'd always tell me about his two mentors, Billy and Dr. Steven. And every now and then I would say something to him, he goes, you know what, my mentor Dr. Steven would tell me like that, and then which made me feel smarter. So I appreciate you, Dr. Steven.
Well, thank you, that's very kind of you. Hopefully I didn't give him any of the bad habits.
So before we move on, I was just to mention a little bit of about Steve. Obviously, it will take another hour to give all the background, but he's currently at Cleveland Clinic, Florida, the director of the Digestive Disease Center. He's the chairman of colorectal surgery, and he was the chairman when I was there back in 1993-94. He's the former president of the American Society of Colorectal Surgeons, also the Society of American Gastroenterology and Endoscopic Surgeons, among other societies. He's the editor-in-chief of prestigious journals in surgery. By the way, I spent many, many hours writing my manuscript, and he would not destroy, but very, very carefully and accurately just add the editing. And I learn a lot about that. That's one of the things that I love doing these days. He, in my view, is the best presenter and moderator in the world. And let me tell you a story about that. The first time I spent a year with him, and I was accepted to provide a presentation at the American College of American Society of Colorectal Surgeons. And I was going to be in front of 500 of colleagues. We'd had a lot more experience than myself. So what we did is, so I had my presentation, and for 6 months before that presentation, he took me to every presentation, every society, and we practiced for 6 months. And by the time I got to the presentation, it was a piece of cake. You know, I could give a lessons about rictocele. Remember, that was the topic back in the day. So he had over 800 manuscripts, more than 300 textbook chapters, and also he's editor of co-editor in over 35 textbooks, which I had the pleasure to write a chapter on one of them. So that's among, you know, all the accolades that he have. And we, again, we could be an hour talking about his background, but very happy to be here. Today, our main focus is on mentoring and how important it is in life and in career. So my first question to you, did you envision being a mentor? By the way, his alumni, who also are mentors of other mentees, is about over 100 in the world. So there are like another 799 other cellos in the world.
But oh, do you know? No.
One way or the other.
799 more of you.
No, better than me, better than me. But did you ever envision such a a thing like that, you know, mentoring and or it came natural to you?
I don't know that that was necessarily part of the very original plan. It was certainly to teach. It was to show people how to do things. That's why I went into academic surgery rather than private practice, to be able to perpetuate, to be able to innovate. It's a little like the adage, if you give somebody a fish, they have a meal. If you teach them to fish, they have a meal every meal the rest of their lives. Kind of the same with patients. I can take care of an individual patient, and that patient hopefully will do quite well. But if I teach people how to take care of patients, then many more patients are going to benefit throughout the world, right? You multifold increase the impact, and you're right. I mean, I'm fortunate that I have alumni in pretty much any country you can name. Many people, including obviously Argentina, where you're from, but all over, and it's great. And you hear stories, and you see them, and how they apply the principles, which isn't just technical, but it's judgment and it's empathy. It's how to treat people for sure.
I have a question, Dr. Steven. As a mentor, what's that feeling like for you when you've mentored somebody and then you either hear or see them later reach the heights that you knew they had the potential to meet that sometimes maybe they didn't even know?
Well, right. And I think that is the difference between levels of mentor. A good mentor can help somebody achieve the goals that they want to achieve, which is mentorship. But if you're also a coach, you're able to envision things that they may not see, and you can get them to uncover talents they didn't know they had or go in a direction they didn't know they'd like. And there's many examples of that throughout my career, where somebody was heading one direction and we changed that direction and they're immensely happy and very successful. And many of my alumni are now chairs of departments, heads of sections, heads of, you know, entire universities. One of them is now president-elect of the European Society of Coloproctology, Oded Zamora from Israel. It makes me tremendously proud, right? I have my children at home. Well, they're not home anymore, but my children, my biologic children. And then I have my children at work, right? And they, just like the kids, they grow up and move away. But that's good, because it makes you very happy to watch them succeed. I think it's really tremendously gratifying to see that happen, and they send people back, right? So you have next generation, like we just heard from Cello, that people go back to whence they came, and then suddenly you get an email or see them at a meeting, and listen, I have this phenomenal person, I want you to train them. And so you start getting multiple generations of people.
And also, let me add, Keoni, to the sense of pride that we all, you know, 800 have about having been and at Cleveland Clinic, Florida, and being ambassadors for life. So, and I should take that back. 799 probably are colorectal surgeons still. I'm the one that actually went a little sideways, but still chasing dreams.
You know? There's a couple of interesting stories I can tell you of some of what. I can think of quite a few. For time permitting, I'm happy to share those with you.
You can share one if you want. Yeah,
share one.
I can think of a couple. Samir Yubara in Panama. He is a businessman. He has a very successful import-export business. He's also a health minister there in Panama. He doesn't practice surgery. Badma Bashenkayev in Moscow still practices surgery, but he's in the Duma. He's in the Russian parliament, which has brought a separate set of issues, because he got elected there about a year ago. And that's a separate story. But he was elected, you know, to their national parliament and is in politics. So those people do all kinds of things.
Any other actors or models?
Come on!
I don't know. I'd have to think. I'm not sure about that one. That one is unique.
Probably another Argentinian or Italian.
You know what's
now that one I think is all yours. I think that one's all yours.
Okay.
What's funny is, Dr. Steven, when you finally see Cello on TV playing a surgeon and doing everything wrong on the episode, that's going to be the funny part. Well, we always say, you know, no matter where you end up, the people who mentor you always make a strong impact. I have two master's degrees. I've never worked a day in any of those fields. And so I have so many actors that I've coached to get at the height of acting, and the next thing you know, they end up being a fashion stylist or something to that effect. So I totally get that with that. Can you tell me about a time, because I asked Dr. Billy this, and he was so excited to answer it. Can you tell me a time where cello was a pain in the butt, oh, just a little bit? Do you have any story where he was a little bit of a pain in the butt when he was a younger tutelage under you?
No, I must say, I can't think of an episode. I think I worked him pretty hard because I remember a picture I had that I know Billy was looking for of him actually totally asleep on the floor with his briefcase across his lap in the floor of the surgeon's lounge because he was working hard. But there's no complaint there. I maybe Billy has different stories than I do. I always enjoyed having him and Rosa both working with us at.
Yeah, let me tell you the background of that, because there was kind of a competition among, you know, the other fellows in who could write the most and get, accepted the most. And also at that time, I was very self-conscious about my accent, my English. So, you know, I said, let's work. So I was working on, 10 papers or so, helping others, and also wanted to be. Everybody wanted to be in all surgeries. So it got to a point that, the only time you had to sleep is in between surgeries. and that's, I'll try to get that picture. Billy loves that one.
I have it somewhere. I don't know that it's in digital format, but I have it.
Well, the reverse order is I asked Cello, when was a time where you were like frustrated with Billy? Like, and Cello was telling about how hard he was on them when Cello was younger, and he's like, hey man, I'm trying to have fun and do this. So tell us about a time where Dr. Steven was a little bit hard on you and you and your brain, you were like, come on, just relax a little bit.
No, to be honest with you, he was very, the level of expectations for everybody, he had it very high because he was the one doing it. So, sometimes, like I said before, sometimes you would work so hard on a paper and you thought it was phenomenal, and then you would give it to him and he would read it like in 10, 15 minutes. First thing in the morning, when we used to do the anorectal physiology lab at 5 a.m. or so, he would give back the whatever you were writing, and you would say, great. But then you started looking at the changes, but every change made sense. So, and it's not changing what you write, but just editing and putting the right words. And that really helped me. You know, when you send abstracts, which is a very summary of the things, and it has to be less than 80 words or something, it's fundamental to have that ability. So, but he was so busy that, most of the frustration was trying to get the attention. But let me tell you one thing. I believe I was the very first international fellow that he took on a trip to another country or continent.
Madrid. Spain, right?
Spain, to Madrid.
Madrid, Spain, absolutely.
And I was so thrilled about it because, in my view, it was, kind of the award for working so hard. So it meant the world. But I was very introverted, so I wanted to be fun. But I remember the first time we had to go for dinner. I don't know if you remember, but at 10 at
night. Yeah, it was with Moreno Gonzalez.
Yes. And to get the, and we started at 10 at night with the ham and everything else. So the next day we just went by ourselves, and I believe, I don't remember the name of the British colleague, the surgeon, but we went like at 6 in the afternoon. But yeah. It was so funny, so fun.
Dr. Steven, who was that person when you were coming through the ranks that was impactful as a mentor for you, and what is the fondest memory that you have of that mentor?
Well, it's interesting because I was quite deliberately an English major in college at Columbia University, so that I'd learn to write, thinking I might, it would come in handy later, not realizing exactly what I'd do other than surgery. And when I was a general surgery resident in New York at the Roosevelt Hospital, I had two mentors, one of whom did exactly to me what I ended up then doing to Cello and to you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of others over the years, to this very day when I have at the moment people with me from Egypt, from Israel, from Greece, from Nigeria, from Australia, I mean, you know, all of various places around Switzerland, you know, doing the same thing, right? He used to do that to me. In those days, now it's Word documents. In those days, it was red ink that he would, you know, write all over it.
Right.
But it was a tremendous learning experience. And his name was Tom Daly, long ago retired. He was really that first one. And then I had two others who gave me opportunities, Stanley Goldberg at the University of Minnesota and a fellow named Bill Heald from the UK. And both of them really helped shape who I am. And ultimately, the guy who recruited me to Florida in 1987, David Jagelman. So I put four or five people up there, who each of whom made a mark. But the common denominator of all of them is they're totally committed, passionate to what they do. You know, David unfortunately passed away in 1993, is 53 years old. Tom retired, he had a medical issue. But the other two, Bill Heald and Stanley Goldberg, are both in their upper, well, shall we say, octogenarian bracket. And they both still work, okay? I mean, they both still work. They don't do exactly what they used to do, but they are both on the lecture circuit, they're both writing, they both show up at meetings, and they both do stuff in the hospital. You know, so they're still going. And listening to what Cello said about me, I mean, it's the same thing. I got home last night at, I don't know, 9:30 after surgery, 10 o'clock, had some dinner. I woke up at 4. I had a lecture at 5:30 this morning to a university in India before I made rounds, and then did a variety of other things. Took care of a lot of patients today. Came home to do this, and I have a webinar to follow. So some things never change, okay? And so I, you know, my expectations, as you say, are that you know who I am. By this point, people know how I work. So if you want to be with me, it's because you want to kind of emulate that style. Because to come with me and just kind of cruise, there'd be no point. You're not going to grow any benefit.
It was interesting. You were texting me back yesterday at 10:30 in the morning, and at 10:30 at night. And then I saw a text from you at 4:30 in the morning today. Right. But that change in you, is that Argentinian influence that now you're up so late?
No, that's just the quantity of work I have. That's just that.
Hey, Keoni, for the record, I'm not talking about my Argentinian influence.
I wasn't making any assumptions. I'm just
My much better half is also from Buenos Aires.
Okay.
Barrio Norte, to be specific, but she's Argentinian. So, yes, most of it is work related. So the getting up early hasn't changed. It's just going to bed later, perhaps. But there's just more work to be done. And now that we're stabilized with COVID, the travel's come back into the schedule. Right? It was kind of a little easier when we were all doing this and nothing but this for 2 years. But now, you know, it's this plus life. Right?
Which is a preference of yours? Did you enjoy the traveling and actually seeing people and connecting in person, or do you like just doing the webcast better?
No, I love travel. I mean, I love travel. I'm good. Absolutely. That again, that has not changed from 1993. I still love running around the world, speaking in meetings, seeing people, seeing my alumni, meeting people who want to come train with me, whatever. Yeah, sharing knowledge, doing surgery, you know, when possible and legal and all the rest of it. So I very much love that. But adding this layer on adds more things to do, but also allows you to do things. For example, the lecture this morning to India, or this conversation now. I mean, if I needed to also add a trip to India and also go to your studio, I couldn't do all this stuff.
Right.
Correct. Yeah, that is
good. Yeah, and to put in the time perspective, when I was doing the fellowship, was the time also that laparoscopic surgery, which is a joystick, remember that I told you, was going more into the colorectal arena. And he was one of the pioneers in doing that. Oh, I think somebody went online. So, you were one of the pioneers, and I see the advancement that now all these robotic surgery and things like that, and you were always also pioneering on all that. So
yes,
you were ahead of the curve back then, and now you're still ahead of the curve on that.
Yeah, I have a program tomorrow morning on the advances in surgery channel on robotic, how to teach robotic, you know, optimal ways to teach robotic surgery. So yes, I'm still.
There's a funny thing that Billy said the other day. I think he had some trouble logging in, but he said that when that started, and his mentor was also David Jagelman, and he was kind of having more difficulties getting into the laparoscopic thing, and he said that you were so good at it, you know, being much younger. So he told the story much better than I do, but it was funny, and I remember that. So my question to you is, as you engaged into mentoring, was that something that is, to be a mentor, is that something that is natural, is instinctive? You can get some kind of, you know, better at it practice or it's something like I always say every doctor has like a teacher in oneself.
Well, again, I reflect on who mentored me, and I picked up what I think are the better traits from them, or at least the ones that were better for me, and then try and augment those and try and develop. You can always get better at anything you do, whether it's, you know, golf like you like, or you know, surgery, or you know, whatever it happens to be, tennis or cooking. I mean, you pick it, playing an instrument. You always can get better, right? And you have to strive to get better. And you get better by modeling your behavior on other people, picking up traits you like, being conscious not to have behavior that you've seen that you don't like, right? It's both positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement. Asking people, you know, being honest, having a 360 and talking to people, say, you know, how do I do? What could I do better? What don't you like? And kind of a little bit like Keone asked you, you know, what did I do as a pain in the neck, and what did I do that was rewarding, right? But then being honest and reflective on yourself. So I think I'm probably a much better mentor now than I was, you know, 29 years ago with you, just because I've tried to get better, very consciously to get better. I think, you know, some people don't want to be bothered. Other people just do it begrudgingly. Some people do it but don't change. But I think like anything else, you know, if you want to do it, you've got to take it seriously and progress. And I think you can tell by your mentees and how they respond. And when people thrive in the environment and ask, gee, I want to stay another year, and I want to stay a third year, and so on and so forth, I want to send you my mentees later in life, then you know you're doing something right.
How you can say how well you are, how important is it for a mentor to know how to cater towards each individual person? Because everyone's had mentors in their life, and I've had mentors where they try to do the same thing with every single person, and I don't think it quite works that well. And I think some of them do that because it takes a lot more energy to cater things to each individual person. Are you good at doing that, and how important is it to do that?
No, I think if you're effective, you have to, and again, that's where you transition from mentoring to coaching, right? Coaching is asset-based. So you want to work with people. And by the way, I picked up a lot of this lingo from Mariana, who spent 3 years getting a master's degree in conflict resolution after spending several years before that becoming certified as a coach. So, you know, I try and learn vicariously from her too. So, you know, it's asset-based. So if I have somebody who, for example, you know, is self-conscious at speaking, and they don't really want to work on it like Cello did, right? I think trying to push them to give lectures is probably the wrong approach. Very often we see that with certain countries where it's more difficult to transition to English, non-Latin language countries in particular, and some are great at writing and they can translate in their heads and, you know, do things, they can write well, they don't want to speak, so fine, you focus on that person on writing, somebody else on speaking, somebody else even for types of surgery that people want to do, where they want to head. So yes, you do need to sit and ask, you know, what is it you're looking to get? What are your expectations? What do you like and dislike? Where do you see yourself in 1 year, 5 years, 20 years? and then try and work with the person in that regard. Now, if somebody comes to me and they say, well, I want to, you know, be a, as you said earlier, fashion model or an actor, I'd say you probably got the wrong guy here. But if they say, okay, I want to work on these things that I know are within your wheelhouse, okay, let's figure out which ones. And I also realize over the years, not everybody wants my lifestyle, and that's fine, right? It works for me. It's not necessarily going to work for everyone else. And, you know, I understand that people have little kids at home, people are younger, people are dating, older people are dating, whatever. And so you have to be respectful of people's quality of life and work-life balance. I can't necessarily expect everyone to do the exact same thing, but I want to help them achieve their goals, and there has to be perhaps a little give and take in some ways. So, okay, you don't want to stay late at night, but maybe when your kids are sleeping at home, you need to work on these things to get them done, right? Which is different than somebody who's happy to stay late. Flexibility.
Would you advise people in career or life to actually seek for mentors, or would you say just stay in your course and a mentor will eventually come to you?
I think seeking out mentors is not only invaluable, but I think in this day and age it is so much easier because of electronic communication and social media. And I you know, in the day when you were with me, it had to be in person. So you were fortunate. You could come from Argentina, and other people came from Brazil and Korea and different kind of Israel and all over the place. People would come, England. Now people contact me. I've never met them, and I can't do exactly the same thing necessarily teaching surgery, but I can help them work with their research. Billy, hey. I can help them work with their research. I can help them prepare presentations. I can work with them in scientific inquiry, write studies, things like that. And so I've remotely mentored many people who I've never met when I started mentoring them. Eventually, now especially with COVID stable, I might see them at a meeting. But in people in countries I wouldn't necessarily visit, and they can't afford, because they're developing countries, to visit me, right? But remotely, electronic media has allowed much more global mentorships. The answer is absolutely seek out a mentor. There may not be, even in the US, you could work down the street from me, but not have a mentor who looks like me, somebody wants to emulate me, fine. So they contact me.
That's really great. Seek out a mentor. There may not be, even in the US,
Billy.
I don't know what happened there, but I guess that's Billy.
Okay, so a question for when you said that, obviously, well, you had great success, about over 800 alumni mentees, but you said that now you feel like you're a better mentor than you were before. What would you change if you could go back in time? What do you think you could have done better back in the day? Or you're doing better now than you were doing, not change?
No, I mean, in many ways, I think I'm doing better at what, you know, Keone asks, tailoring mentoring to people's capabilities, needs, desires. What I don't do as well is because of the amount of commitments I have for various organizations. You mentioned SAGES, the American Society of Colorectal Surgeons, the American College of Surgeons, my journal, surgery, you know, travel, other things. I don't know people as well as I used to, right? In your day, it was a smaller group. I was around more, and I really got to know people and their families. And that's the one thing I do miss now, is that there's just so much going on. It's, you know, it's impossible to really spend time getting to know everybody and their families the way I used to. And I do miss that part of it, but, you know, you can't do everything, unfortunately. At least I can't.
It seems like you really embraced the new era of social media. I was surprised when I started seeing you everywhere. What's your take on that? You saw the potential for better communication, better promotion, better education all over the world.
Yeah, I think it's a great way to spread the message of you know, surgery, of education, any message you want, but in this case, surgery and education, as you have seen from my various posts and tweets, I don't talk about personal things at all. I just limit it to science and promoting my alumni. And anytime I see somebody speaking at a meeting or published a paper or got a promotion or whatever it is, I'll proudly put that out there. But it's a great democratizer, right? And what I mentioned earlier about people who want to be mentors, who want to be mentees, right? They can reach out to me. Now, I don't know that those same people would come up to me after a lecture, even if they could afford to go to the meeting in American College of Surgeons in San Diego, or American Society of Colorectal Surgeons this year in Seattle, or SAGES in Toronto, whatever it is. They may not feel comfortable. They may not be able to afford to go to the meeting. And, you know, it's not a meaningful conversation when you're walking off a podium, but by social media, people can approach you. And it allows, you know, people who are young and in training all over the world, they don't have to be so self-conscious about accents and things, right? They're typing. And so I really embrace it because it allows a lot more people to access me, and I enjoy that.
You're on mute, Keoni.
We're gonna wrap it up here because I know you've got a lot to do, and we want you to have that energy. I would like to tell you this though. During my 20 years in the Army, I switched from combat arms to dental specialist for the last eight wow. years, I ran the 33 chair dental clinic, and I just want you to know that dentist handwriting is worse than doctor's handwriting. I just want you to know that if you didn't know that already.
I didn't know that. That's a great fact. That's a good tidbit.
Yes, and we give them so many tools to make the handwriting better and it's still worse.
Well, now it's all electronic. It's all electronic health records, so you don't have to worry about handwriting. It's all typed.
Well, let me tell you, I was always able to read Steve's handwriting in the edits, so he wasn't that bad.
it may have deteriorated with time.
I think the one thing we should have worked on with Cello, he's very good at shorthand. He's just not good at short speech. I tease him all the time because anytime he's given a speech, he got to speak at our graduation. And every time I hear him speak and he says, "And one last thing, I know there's 30 minutes left."
It's great for me to reconnect with. I mean, it's been too long, so I know awesome. You know we remotely connect, but it's nice to see him on the screen and be here.
Absolutely, but that is an Argentinian thing. I mean, we want to be, you know, center.
I tease him, but he's great.
Yeah, we got to be more concise, and I'm working on it, and that's part of it. That was in the presentations that he gave me. So I'm still working on it.
I'm teasing. It was great. You made my job a lot easier, Dr. Steven. I just want you to know that. You gave me, I don't have as much to work with as I do with most people. So I appreciate
that. I'm glad.
And we're so glad that you took the time out of the day. We know, not to make us sound like we're terrible, such a small channel. We know you're doing so many big and great things out there. And we're just glad that you took the time out of the day to come on our show and talk about mentorship. There's a lot of people that are going to get a lot out of that. Doesn't matter what field you're in, always find a mentor, always learn, always evolve. Cello, you want to take us out?
Yeah, no, just part of the inspirational message that I always like to do, and I always like to do it by example. And this is what I wanted to bring today, you know, one of the main people in my life, and I'm not talking career only, because he was present when we moved to this country 26 years ago, and also was present in my life and my wife's career. So he always, you know, looked after us. He was always looking for if we were doing well. And so I'm here talking to you like I was with Billy, because of him, because of Billy, because of people like that. So a mentor could mean that it's a mentor for your career, but in reality, it's mentors for life. So I really appreciate happy to connect again. I know you're going to Argentina in a couple of days, so enjoy that. I hope we win on Sunday.
Vamos, Argentina.
Yeah.
And sorry, Dr. G, I know you're having connecting issues. I'm glad we got an episode you in. Our apologies that it was hard for you to connect. And we will see everyone in the next year for some exciting new things here on the Cello Show. Thank you, Cello, from co-host Keone, and the wonderful and amazing Dr. Stephen Wexner. You guys all enjoy your nights.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you.